Thank you. friends, today we come together to thank God for this beautiful freedom that He has given us. So today we come to this holy altar in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
May the peace, the love, and the grace of God be always with you.
As we gather
today, we come to listen to the Word of God and to receive His grace in His body. So let us close our eyes for a moment and asking God to help us be a worthy offering for Him. Let us recognize that we're not perfect. And let us ask Him for forgiveness of our sins and the strength of the Holy Spirit to continue proclaiming His word. Lord Jesus, you are our Lord and Savior. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Christ Jesus, you heal us and strengthen us. Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Lord Jesus, your mercy works through us. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life.
Amen.
Now let us unite our voices and hearts to give praise and glory to our God. As we gather today, we pray in a very special way for our beautiful country. We thank God for our freedom. We thank God for His justice. And we pray that as a country, we continue living according to God's commandments. O God, who in the abasement of your Son have raised up a fallen world, fill your faithful with holy joy. For on those you have rescued from slavery to sin, you bestow eternal gladness. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
A reading from the book of the prophet Ezekiel. As the Lord spoke to me, the Spirit entered into me and set me on my feet. And I heard the one who was speaking say to me, Son of man, I am sending you to the Israelites, rebels who have rebelled against me. They and their ancestors have revolted against me to this very day. Hard of face and obstinate of heart are they to whom I am sending you. But you shall say to them, Thus says the Lord God, and whether they heed or resist, for they are a rebellious house, they shall know that a prophet has been among them. The word of the Lord. A reading from the second letter of St. Paul to the Corinthians. Brothers and sisters, that I, Paul, might not become too elated because of the abundance of the revelations, a thorn in the flesh has given to me, an angel of Satan, to beat me, to keep me from being too elated. 3 times I begged the Lord about this, that it might leave me. But he said to me, My grace is sufficient for you, for power is made perfect in weakness. I will rather boast most gladly of my weaknesses in order that the power of Christ may dwell with me. Therefore, I am content with weaknesses, insults, hardships, persecutions, and constraints for the sake of Christ. For when I am weak, then I am strong. The word of the Lord.
The Lord be with you.
And with
a reading from the Holy Gospel according to Mark. Jesus departed from there and came to his native place, accompanied by his disciples. When the Sabbath came, Jesus began to teach in the synagogue, and many who heard him were astonished. They said, "Where did this man get all this? What kind of wisdom has been given to him? What mighty deeds are wrought by his hands? Is not he the carpenter, the son of Mary, and the brother of James and Joseph, and Judas and Simon? And are not his sisters here with us?" And they took offense at him. So Jesus said to them, "A prophet is not without honor except in his native place, and among his own kin, and in his own house." So Jesus was not able to perform any mighty deed there, apart from curing a few sick people by laying his hands on them. Jesus was amazed at their lack of faith. The Gospel of the Lord. There are a few of us here who were involved in visiting the prisons and the jails before the shutdown. And there is a, whenever we go to the prison, usually when we have a Bible study or we have a liturgy of the word of mass, there is usually a few minutes before the celebration that we have, that we are preparing all things together in the chapel, usually it's the men, especially in Norway Heights. The guys come together, usually around me or some of our volunteers, and we start talking about things. And after Mass or after the Bible study or whatever we have in, as we are trying to clean up the chapel and to put things back in order, we get again together and we start talking. And you know, it's you know how we guys are. We really like to talk to each other and share things that we're not supposed to. But you start with two people who are talking, and then suddenly you see it's like 7-8 people in that group who are talking and sharing and doing things like that. However, in Norway Heights, there is a very nice man who it's very, really, how can I say? He is very enthusiastic about his faith and about sharing the word of God. So often you will see these groups of people when we all came together, 6 or 8 of us, and we were talking in this little group, and then this guy will come to the group and start listening to the conversation and start being part of the conversation. And suddenly you will see one guy walking away, and then another guy walking away, and then finally, I was always the last one stuck with him, when I wasn't stuck with him, but that's how I felt sometimes. And this is because this good man, he's so in love with Jesus, and he's so in love with proclaiming the word of God, that it doesn't matter what you are talking about. It doesn't matter if you are talking about cars, or horses, or factories, or work, or something. He always finds a way to bring it back to the Bible. And the guys know him. He's always talking about the Bible. He's always talking about God. And many guys are kind of tired about him. So instead of listening to him, they just go away. They just go away. They disappear, and they don't want to listen and talk to him. This also happens sometimes when I visit, especially all the older people or people at the hospital. A few months ago or so, I was visiting somebody at the hospital. They called me to go and to see her, to listen to her confession and giving her the anointing of the sick and communion. And as I got to her room, her daughter was there. this woman was maybe in her 90s, late 80s or something like that. And then her daughter was in her 30s or so. So as I got there, I introduced myself and I introduced myself to the daughter and all this. And the mom started telling me about her life and this and that. And said, oh, thank you, Father, for coming. Thank you for listening to my confession. And you know, my daughter, she's a very good woman, but she hasn't been in church in a long time. Maybe she would like to go to confession after me. And you could see the younger woman, she just wanted to disappear. I mean, she was all red and just looking at me and say, oh, mom, please stop it. And so I tried to make it easy for the younger woman. Say, oh, don't worry, that's fine, and this and that. And afterwards, she went outside of the room, and the older woman and I had confession, and then we invited the other woman, the younger woman, to come back to the room. And then when I was saying goodbye to them, I told the younger woman, you know, if you really want to come to confession, I do have time. But you're always welcome to come and visit us. And I tried to invite her to come back to church, but I tried to do it in a nice way. But I tell you this because, her first reaction when her mom was telling me that she had not been in confession and in church for a long time, it was the younger woman was, oh, mom, please stop it. Don't start with this and don't start with that. Many times that's what happens when we hear the message, when we hear the word of God from somebody that it's close to us. It's easy for us sometimes as people not only to attack, but sometimes it's easier for us when somebody close to us starts proclaiming the word of God to run away or to dismiss this person, or as I said before, sometimes even to attack them. There was a friend of mine who was sharing with me that her dad, when they were growing up, he did not have a relationship with God. And unfortunately, she doesn't remember this, but unfortunately, it looks like his dad was not a very good husband, and he was not very good with her dad as they were growing up. Thank God this man found Jesus, and now he has a relationship with God. And his wife passed away some years ago. But as he has become a better person, one of his sons was having maybe relationships with his own wife. And the father was telling his son, you know, you have to be nice to your wife. It's not easy to have a relationship with her. Sometimes your wife gets on your nerves, but you have to be nice to her and to remember that this is the woman that God has given you. So please be nice to her. And the son turned around and said, At least I am not as mean as you used to be with my mom. And then the older man just looked down and went to do whatever she was doing. I mean, sometimes we do not want to hear the message that people are giving us, this message coming from God, and we even attack other people. As Christians, it's something that we have to be very careful. As Christians, it's something that we have to remember. That's what happened today to Ezekiel, who about 400 years before Jesus, he was chosen by God to go and to proclaim the word of God to his own people. And instead of people listening to him, they started attacking him. They started telling him, who do you think you are to come and to tell us that we have gone away from God? It's the same thing that happened to St. Paul today. As the Corinthians are not listening to him anymore because they have seen that St. Paul is not perfect, he is coming and recognizing and saying, yes, I do have a lot of weaknesses. Yes, I am not perfect. But that's why it's so amazing. It's even more amazing that God has chosen me to proclaim his word. It's more amazing that God has chosen me to bring you this message that God wants you to listen to. And it's the same thing that happened to Jesus. As he was trying to proclaim the word of God, and as he was trying to work miracles, people dismissed him because they thought they knew who he was. Isn't he Jesus? Isn't he the carpenter? Isn't his mom and his sisters and his brothers here among us? So who do you think he is? We as Christians have to remember that very often in our lives, God has chosen God has chosen the people who are closest to us. God has chosen people who are as imperfect as we are to come and to bring the message of God to each one of us. And we should never close our eyes. We should never close our ears. We should never close our hearts to this message that people are proclaiming. We have to be, as Christians, we have to be less demanding with other people. As Christians, we have to be less demanding with all the people who are bringing this message of God to each one of us. Yes, the people around are not perfect. Yes, sometimes people in our families commit mistakes and have a lot of weaknesses. But they have been chosen by God, just like Ezekiel was, just like St. Paul was, just like Jesus was. They have been chosen by God, Ezekiel, just like Ezekiel and St. Paul, with their own imperfections, they have been chosen by God to be the people who bring his message to all of us. And at the same time, we also have to remember that as we prayed that we're less demanding with the people who bring God's messages to each one of us, that we also have to be less demanding with each one of us. Just as God has chosen other people, our family and friends, to bring his message to us, God has also chosen each one of us. God has chosen each one of us to be these messengers for others, in our families, in a group of friends. And sometimes, because we know that we're not perfect, because we know that we're not worthy to come and to proclaim his word, we prefer to be quiet. We prefer to go away. We prefer not to say anything in order not to be attacked or in order not to be in a discussion with somebody else. It just happened to me, and I told you that's one of the, it doesn't happen as much. It was more when my brothers and sisters were growing up. But one of the things when I knew I was going to go back to Mexico and visit my family, that was one of the things that I always feared, that I knew that going home, my mom was going to have a big list for me of all the things that my brothers and my sisters had done, all the wrong things that they had done, and my mom wanted me to go and talk to them and fix things for the family. So I always there to do that. That's the thing that most I fear the most. I called my mom, I think it was yesterday, or I don't even remember anymore. I don't know if it was yesterday morning or this morning. I called her this morning and I asked her how she was doing, and I asked her how she was doing, and she said she was doing fine. But then I know her voice, and she stopped for a little bit, and she said, "I am fine, I'm doing fine. But the one you should talk to, it's your brother. You should talk to him because he's not fine. He had to go and see the doctor because he was not feeling well." But just that moment of silence, when my mom told me that she was fine, and I knew she wanted to tell me something, but at the same time she was not ready to tell me. I don't know, it was a couple of seconds that my mom stopped, my heart stopped too. I mean, right away I knew she was gonna give me bad news, and I thought it was something worse. So I knew, my first reaction was to hang up the phone or something, not to listen to her. Because I thought they had gotten in trouble or somebody, and I had to talk to somebody in my family. Sometimes when you have to bring the word of God to other people, especially somebody in your family, it's scary. It's not something easy. And many times we want to run away, or many times we want to be quiet because we don't want to get in trouble. But we also have to remember that God has chosen each one of us, just like he chose Ezekiel, or just like he chose St. Paul, to be the persons who bring this message, to bring this message to the people that God wants us to speak to. And we have to remember that we're not perfect. But the important thing about this, that God has chosen us, it's not really the person that God has chosen, but the important thing, it's the message that God wants our brothers and sisters to listen to. So as we gather today and as we come to receive the grace, God's grace on his body, let us pray. Let us pray that we may be less demanding with the people who bring his message to us, but at the same time, that we may be less demanding with ourselves as we fulfill the mission that God has given us. Now let us stand. And we believe that we are God's messengers because we have faith in him. So let us profess the faith that God has given us as we say, I believe in one God. As we rejoice today that God has chosen us the way we are to be his prophets, let us present to him all of our prayers and needs. For the church, that each one of us may be strengthened by the Spirit to be ever faithful to our baptismal calling to proclaim Christ to the world, we pray to the Lord. For our country, that our citizens may be faithful to the Christian values on which it was founded, we pray to the Lord. For all Christians, that one day we may come together to God's holy altar, we pray to the Lord. For all who have died, that they may have peace and joy in the presence of God, we pray to the Lord. For all those who are suffering from this heat, especially the homeless and those who work outside, that God may protect them, we pray to the Lord. For all of us, that God may teach us how to support husbands and wives in their efforts to be faithful, we pray to the Lord. What else shall we pray for? Lord, hear our prayer.
Lord, increase the vocations to the priesthood and the religious life. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For Father Danielle, Father Thomas, Father Patrick, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For my sister-in-law who passed away this past week, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer. And let us pray for all those who are part of the military forces, all those people who are risking their lives, and especially all those who are away from their families, to protect our freedom, to bring justice to our country, to our world. that God may always keep them safe and bless them for their goodness and generosity, we pray to the Lord. Loving God, we ask you to bring us coolness in the heat and to send your living waters upon our land. Please help us accept ourselves the way we are, so your grace may work in us to become a worthy offering for you. Today we place all of our prayers on your holy altar through the intercession of Our Lady of Fatima and Blessed Emily Gamelin, and in the name of Jesus Christ our Lord. Now let us pray, brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. O Lord, may this oblation dedicated to your name purify us, and day by day, bring our conduct closer to the life of heaven through Christ our Lord. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It's truly right and just. It's our duty and our salvation to give you thanks and raise to you a hymn of glory and praise, O Lord Father of infinite goodness. For by the word of your Son's gospel, you have brought together one church from every people, tongue, and nation. And having filled her with life by the power of your Holy Spirit, you never cease through her to gather the whole human race into one. And manifesting the covenant of your love, your church dispenses without ceasing the blessed hope of your kingdom, and shines bright the sign of your faithfulness, which in Christ Jesus our Lord, you promise will last for eternity. And so with all the powers of heaven, we worship you constantly on earth, while with all the church, as one voice, we acclaim. You are indeed holy and to be glorified, O God, who loved the human race and who always walk with us on the journey of life. Blessed indeed is your Son Jesus, present here in our midst when we're gathered by his love. And when, as once for his disciples and now for us, he opens the scriptures and breaks the bread. Therefore, Father most merciful, we ask that you send forth your Holy Spirit to sanctify these gifts of bread and wine, so that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, he took bread and said a blessing. He broke the bread and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, gave you thanks, and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith. Therefore, Holy Father, as we celebrate the memorial of Christ, your Son, our Savior, whom you led through his passion and dead on the cross to the glory of the resurrection, and whom you have seated at your right hand, we proclaim the work of your love until he comes again, and we offer you the bread of life and the chalice of eternal blessing. Look with favor on the oblation of your church, in which we show forth the paschal sacrifice of Christ that has been entrusted to us, and grant that by the power of your Holy Spirit we may be counted now and until the day of eternity among the members of your Son, in whose body and blood we have communion. Lord, renew your church of Spokane by the light of the gospel. Strengthen the bonds of unity between the faithful and the pastors of your people, together with Francis our Pope, Thomas our Bishop, and the whole order of bishops, that in a world torn by strife and conflict, your people may shine forth as a prophetic sign of unity, peace, and concord. Remember also our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the peace of your Christ. Admit them to rejoice in the light of your face, and in the resurrection, give them the fullness of life. Grant also to each one of us, when our earthly pilgrimage is done, that we may come to an eternal dwelling place and live with you forever. There, in communion with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with her husband Saint Joseph, with the apostles and martyrs, Blessed Emily Gamelin, and all the saints, we shall praise and exalt you through Jesus Christ our Lord. Through him and with him and in him, O God Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. Thank you. Now, as brothers and sisters who recognize that God has chosen us to bring his message to others, let us pray together. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you," look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be always with you.
Amen.
Now, still respecting social distancing, let us offer each other a sign of peace. Take away the sins of the world. Have mercy upon us.
Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world. Have mercy upon us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world.
Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. The body of Christ. The body of Christ. The body of Christ. The body of Christ.
Thank you.
Let us pray. O Lord, grant that having been replenished by such great gifts, we may gain the prize of salvation and never cease to praise you through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you. May Almighty God bless you, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
As we thank God today for the many blessings that He has given us, I wish that you have a wonderful and safe 4th of July. Okay? And don't forget to thank God for the many blessings that God has given not only to our country, but that He has given to all of us. As we go out, I just remind you that we have 3 different exits if you want to use all of them so that we are able to have a little bit more of a healthy distance. Now let us go in peace to share with others all the graces that God has given us and His message. Our Mass is ended. Thank you for coming today. Have a wonderful, wonderful week.
Our recessional hymn is number 874.